Our next lecture will be from Dr. Jack Shaw, which is a visit to the orthodontist in the 2020s, how emerging technologies will transform orthodontics. Mr. Jack Shaw graduated from Yale University and got his MBA from Northwestern University. He has been a technology futurist for over 30 years, helping others understand the strategic implications of emerging technologies. Over 12,000 meeting planners, executives, and conference attendees from around the world also voted Jack as one of the world's top 5 technology futurists for 2014. Mr. Shaw has provided advisory services to leading technology solution providers for over 25 years, including IBM, SAP, Oracle, CA Technologies, and others. He also delivered expert guidance to many Fortune 500 companies such as General Electric and Coca-Cola, as well as hundreds of small to mid-sized businesses. As a business and technology strategist, Jack has spent his career helping companies from many industries and helping the providers of their technologies to find better ways to conduct and operate their businesses. Please welcome Mr. Jack Shaw.
Salaam alaikum. Good morning. It is a very great pleasure and a very great honor to be invited to deliver the keynote presentation for the 12th annual conference of the Saudi Orthodontic Society. I'd like to start by thanking Dr. Iman Al-Namnakani for her kind invitation and her very hard work over the past 1 year to enable me to be here with you today. Thank you, Dr. Al-Namnakani. And I would also like to thank you for the most gracious hospitality shown to me by Dr. Iman and by the conference committee, the Saudi Orthodontic Society, and the very nice people I have met in the past 2 days since I arrived on this, my very first trip to Saudi Arabia. Thank you. Shukran. Traveling can be an excellent educational experience. So I would like to invite you this morning to travel with me, not to a different geographical location, but to a new time. So please join me on a short trip to the near future as we make a visit to the orthodontist in the 2020s. This is May. She's 12 years old. She just moved here from Japan with her parents a few weeks ago when her mother accepted a position as professor at a prestigious local university. As you can see, May needs orthodontic work. Knowing this, her parents decided to wait until after they arrived here in Saudi Arabia to start her orthodontic work so she could finish it during her mother's professorial stay over the next couple of years. While May is picking up Arabic quickly, she still does not yet speak or understand it very well. As we'll see, that won't be a problem. The process starts when May and her father go to the closest local walk-in healthcare clinic. There, May is seen by a physician assistant who, among other things, has had several months training as an orthodontic assistant. The physician assistant first takes a photo of May and then uses a scanner approximately the size of a large electric toothbrush to thoroughly scan May's oral cavity in about 1 minute. The physician assistant then shows May and her father a selection of augmented reality images of May's own face with a range of different smiles based on those typical for Asian women of Japanese and other cultures. With her father's help, May then selects the look that she likes best. May's photo, her intraoral scan, and her desired appearance are then uploaded to her blockchain-based online electronic health record. Through an app on May's flexible smartphone, she and her father authorize the sharing of this information, along with her insurance coverage and contact information, to certified orthodontists who have offices within a 15-minute drive of May's home. This is Dr. Noura Khan, an orthodontist whose practice is based in an office about 8 minutes' drive from May's home. She has an app running on her practice management system that, among other things, continually scans for prospective new patients. The app notifies her that a 12-year-old named May, who lives nearby, is looking for orthodontic services. Dr. Khan's practice management app analyzes the information from May's health record for her case, her intraoral scan, her desired outcome, and her insurance coverage. It then develops 3 preliminary alternative treatment plans. These are each based on producing the desired outcome quickly and cost-effectively for the patient and profitably for the orthodontist. Dr. Khan reviews the 3 plans. She eliminates one which she feels is not likely to produce the desired results as reliably as the other 2. She then asks her practice management system's intelligent assistant to schedule a conference call with May and her father for 10 minutes at a time which is available on all 3 of their calendars. It turns out there's a time slot open early that afternoon. On receipt of the call from Dr. Khan, May and her father's smartphones instantly detect that Dr. Khan is speaking Arabic and translate her speech fluently into Japanese. Dr. Khan's phone does the same thing so that each participant can both speak and hear clearly in the language of their choice. Later in the office, the same thing will be accomplished via nearly invisible earbuds each person will be wearing and or which are wirelessly connected to their smartphone's translation apps. After introducing herself, Dr. Khan explains the 2 options she recommends and the advantages, timing, and costs associated with each. After some discussion, May and her father decide that they like Dr. Khan and agree to schedule an initial appointment. Their intelligent assistants consult their respective calendars and identify a mutually convenient appointment time for early morning the day after tomorrow. When May and her father arrive at Dr. Khan's office, they check in with the robotic receptionist, who of course speaks Japanese fluently, along with approximately 600 other languages. May is a bit taken aback when the receptionist tells her that her initial examination is going to be done by a human assistant. Her father explains to the receptionist that in Japan, virtually all medical, dental, and orthodontic assistants are robots. The receptionist reassures May that Mr. Mohammed, who will perform the initial examination, is both very experienced and very personable, and that in fact he has a granddaughter the same age as May. She also explains to May's father that Dr. Khan has already selected an excellent robotic assistant, which she will be using once Mr. Mohammed retires next year, after having completed training of his replacement, of course. After Mr. Mohammed has completed the preliminary exam, he reports to Dr. Khan that the analysis of the treatment planning system appears to be valid. Then Dr. Khan conducts her own examination and comes to the same conclusion as Mr. Mohammed. She shows May on the image display screen and her father a few key points and explains how and why the two alternative treatment plans differ. She concludes by recommending treatment plan B. Treatment plan B will take a little longer than plan A, 4 months versus 3 months, but the out-of-pocket costs will be considerably less for May's family, and the long-term results should be superior. For her own part, Dr. Khan's margin will be slightly less, but still well within her practice guidelines. May and her father agree that Plan B is the way to go. So the three of them authorize the treatment plan and the related payment schedule through their smartphones. This information is all recorded in a blockchain-based online smart contract linked to May's electronic health record. Once the smart contract has been executed, Dr. Khan is then authorized to download the design for a customized set of dynamic smart braces to the 3D printers in her office. These braces are descendants of smart brackets originally developed at the University of Freiburg in Germany way back in the early 2010s. May's appliance will include brackets which continually monitor 6 vectors of force and movement for each tooth, adjust those vectors dynamically in accordance with the treatment plan, and upload the data continuously to her electronic health record via their built-in Internet of Things circuitry. Once the appliance designs have been downloaded, they are printed out in 4 parts on 2 of Dr. Khan's 3D printers, 1 printer for the ceramic parts and 1 for the metallic. Dr. Khan then assembles each set of braces and places them on May's teeth. The entire process of downloading the designs and printing, assembly, and placement is completed in just under 1 hour. May and her father approve the appliance through their smartphones and leave the office very excited about May's new braces. On receipt of the approval of the placement of the braces, the online smart contract automatically transfers funds for the agreed initial payment from both May's family's insurance company and from the designated account for their copayment to Dr. Khan. Dr. Khan's account is credited for the payment by the time May and her father reach the sidewalk. That's the part most orthodontists like best. Over the next 30 days, Dr. Khan's intelligent assistant monitors May's treatment daily. On 2 occasions when it seems warranted, it notifies Dr. Khan to take a look at the results herself. In each case, after a couple of minutes review, Dr. Khan concludes that May's treatment is progressing within appropriate parameters. Every 30 days, May consults with Dr. Khan remotely to review her progress and provide personal feedback to the doctor. On the second such occasion, Dr. Khan tells May that she recommends adjusting the treatment plan slightly to produce better long-term results. She explains that after the adjustment, May will feel a little additional pressure on her upper right molars for the next few days. May agrees, and so the doctor transmits the appropriate adjustment to May's braces electronically, which begin applying the change that night while May is sleeping. At the completion of each remote consultation, any changes to the treatment plan are recorded in May's online electronic health record, and progress payments are automatically transferred to Dr. Khan via the smart contract. After 4 months, May returns to Dr. Khan's office for the final examination. They both agree that the treatment has produced the desired outcome. Dr. Khan removes the braces for the materials to be recycled. The smart contract automatically transfers funds for the final payment to her account, and May walks out of her office with a smile a mile wide. Now, is that pretty much the way it works in your practice today? Not yet? Well, perhaps not. So let us ask what it is that you're having to deal with. There's tremendous change taking place in orthodontics. And some orthodontists are dealing with future shock. What is the impact of Invisalign going to be on orthodontics in the future? Is there going to be a role for orthodontists anymore? What about new kinds of appliances as we move from metal to ceramics? 3D printing, with the excellent presentation we just saw, talking about some of the key developments currently in 3D printers, which will only continue to accelerate in the upcoming years. And the Internet of Things, with embedded sensors directly in brackets, braces, and other kinds of appliances. What's going to be the impact of dental group management practices, of dental and orthodontic tourism, patient-centered healthcare in general? All of these things are issues that orthodontists need to be thinking about and planning for, not just in the short term, but also in the longer term, as you look down the road 2 to 3 to 5 or even 10 years into the future of your practice. One of the challenges is what's referred to by some people as the rise of the expert, non-expert, generalized dental practitioners, upsetting the traditional role of the specialist orthodontists. An almost complete lack of understanding on the part of most patients in the general public as to the professional capabilities of orthodontic specialists and how and why those are different from traditional dental generalists, with the impression that generalists are somehow better equipped to address the needs of the patient as a whole, that comprehensive dental treatment adding to the convenience of care under one roof, why should we go to different people? These are questions in people's minds that the orthodontic profession needs to be able to address. We're also seeing dental tourism. I myself recently had a new crown put in, and quite frankly, I was tempted by the fact that for the same amount of money that it cost me to have the crown put in my hometown of Atlanta, had I had the time, I could have purchased round-trip airplane tickets and a long weekend stay in Cancun to have a very similar crown put in. In my case, I didn't have the extra time to make the stay, but some people might have said, you know what, let's take the savings on in this case, the dental work, and go get a free vacation in addition at the same time. One of the things that we're seeing in this increasingly diverse world of ours, just in the 2 days since I've been in Saudi Arabia, I've met or seen people from at least a dozen different countries. And that happens everywhere I go around the world. I meet people from all over the world, people from different racial and ethnic backgrounds. And while it is absolutely true that a smile is a universal language, not all cultures' smiles are the same as all others. And one of the things orthodontists are dealing with now is a much broader array of people from different parts of the world, different racial and ethnic backgrounds, different ideas of what constitutes a smile in their own cultural milieu. We're also seeing an explosion in the use of mobile systems over the last 10 years now since smartphones have emerged. And again, it doesn't matter where I travel in the world, everyone is using smartphones. So integrating mobility into your dental practice is also important.
Weave is a simple communication tool that makes running the front office easier while strengthening relationships with your patients. When a patient calls your office, Weave displays who's calling. No need to ask how to spell their name or put them on hold to look up their info. It instantly prompts you with relevant patient details, preparing you for more efficient, more meaningful interactions. And it highlights upcoming or missed appointments so you can remind or reschedule them while on the call. Weave even reminds you of outstanding balances so payments can be collected while patients are still on the phone. And it remembers important details like birthdays so that they know you care. With Weave, staying in touch means real conversations that help you be more efficient and provide the service experience patients want. And checking the schedule can happen whenever, wherever you want. Weave makes life simple for you and better for your patients, from the moment they call to the moment they walk into the office. Meet Weave, the beautiful, simple way to keep your chairs full and your patients happy.
And as Dr. Nguyen pointed out in his presentation earlier, while most people cannot achieve the accelerated speeds of intraoral scanning that the top technicians in the world can today, nevertheless, the technology is getting better and faster. It will be easier in the near future for them to be able to do so. We're also going to see increased use of augmented reality in orthodontics. We're already beginning to see some of that, as you can see an example here. And extending these capabilities into the near future, patients will actually be able to see what their faces will look like as a result of the successful application of orthodontic treatments using enhanced augmented reality capabilities. 3D printing is going to continue to evolve and accelerate. We, again, just saw an excellent presentation on the current state of the art of 3D printing. It's being used for everything from the world's smallest lithium-ion battery that you can see perched on the tip of this pencil to this 400-pound bioplastic cornerstone used for building a canal house in Amsterdam. We've also seen 3D printing of bionic parts, such as an ear that actually has the hearing aid built into the ear itself for a patient and needs to have replaced. So in orthodontics, we're going to see 3D printing both by specialty manufacturers, which we already see. Printing of models in orthodontic offices, of course, is taking place. We're starting to see the beginning of printing appliances in orthodontic offices, which Dr. Nguyen referred to. And again, he talked a little bit about the continuous liquid interface production, or CLIP 3D printing. Here's a short video explaining how that came about.
A bunch of scientists from a company called Carbon 3D just introduced a totally new kind of 3D printing. They were actually inspired to make it from the movie Terminator 2. Conventional 3D printing involves a printing head that passes over and over across a platform, depositing a thin layer of material each time. And this 3D printing forms an object continuously out of a liquid resin. So what's happening here is you have a bath of liquid resin that solidifies when light hits it. So the platform dips into this resin, and as it rises up, you have a projector underneath the resin pool that's projecting a series of cross-sectional images that are in the exact shape of the object you want to make. So as the platform slowly moves upwards, the projector moves through the different images, the different cross-sections, and that causes the object to form in the shape you want. Wherever there's ultraviolet light hitting it, that's where the plastic solidifies. So this could be a big deal because it's a lot faster than conventional 3D printers. It works in minutes instead of hours. Right now, 3D printing is still kind of a niche industry. People use it to make models or prototypes, but if this new 3D printer can be perfected, it could be possible for it to be used to make mass-produced goods.
And these technologies are coming together to create new kinds of appliances.
The Aerodentist system is based on a custom-made thermoplastic mouthpiece that fits over the teeth, equipped with an integrated inflatable silicone balloon. The mouthpiece is manufactured using CAD/CAM technology and 3D imaging. The resulting precision makes it possible to preset the exact movement required to position each tooth in its ideal position. A small control console applies pulsating physiological force on the teeth. This is a proven effective modality for orthodontic treatment. Pulsating force means that the inflation phase is followed by deflation. This relieves the pressure applied to the teeth and helps to prevent obstruction or closure of blood vessels. This pulsating force ensures adequate blood supply to the periodontal ligament cells throughout the entire duration of the treatment period. This potentially helps reduce various risks that may happen as a result of the application of continuous force used in conventional orthodontic treatments. Aerodentist treatment is not only more effective, but also a healthier, safer treatment. And no less important, a much more comfortable one. Only approximately 10 hours per day of active treatment is needed. The rest of the time, patients are completely free from any orthodontic devices.
When it comes to Internet of Things technology, the concept is that things in our environment, not just our digital devices, but otherwise what previously were static things, will have electronic circuitry added to or built into them that allow those things to convey information, sensors, data communications capabilities that then can be used for everything from healthcare to a host of other applications in other fields around the world. Already, at the University of Warwick in the UK, under Dr. Simon Lee and his team, they have developed the ability to 3D print electronic devices with a new kind of plastic called carbomorph that conducts electricity. They've already 3D printed small computers, specialist gloves, and so forth. So what this means is that in the near future, you will be able to 3D print brackets and braces that have microelectronics sensors and microelectronic mechanical devices built into them that will enable you to be able to both affect treatment and monitor treatments on an ongoing basis, and that will communicate on an ongoing basis with patients' electronic health records and the systems and people that are providing their health care with that information. Internet of Things has got great potential for the future. And most of us have heard about other kinds of wearable devices. How many people wear some kind of Fitbit or other wearable devices for exercise? Some of you do here? All right, very good. More and more people will be doing that. And it'll give you important information. As our good cartoon friend Dilbert finds out when his rather skeptical colleague says to him, "Your health sensors you built into your smart watch prototype aren't working, because according to your stupid sensors, my heart is going to stop beating in..." Yay me! Well, hopefully the outcome of wearing wearable healthcare sensors will be a more positive for most people. That already includes devices such as a smart toothbrush that will not only time itself for whether or not you brushed your teeth long enough, but keep track of how often you're brushing your teeth or using it as whether you should be or not. Great for keeping track of the kids. Smart devices, as we've already seen, here's an example.
Our device is simple. A small microsensor embedded in acrylic uses encoded algorithms to monitor how long the retainer is in the oral cavity. The medical-grade informatics are transferred with an encrypted reader using proprietary software to the orthodontist's computer screen.
The smart retainer is a low-cost, high-tech solution that is becoming the standard of care for orthodontists, allowing each doctor to minimize the time, cost, and stress associated with relapse and put the responsibility of compliance where it belongs, on the patient.
And even a smart tooth.
The idea with Smart Tooth is to take an everyday acrylic-based prosthetic and house inside it a microprocessing unit alongside a lithium ceramic battery cell that's completely safe and biocompatible, and use a low-frequency radio signal to transmit data in real time to a handheld device. That would let us see the dynamic effects of exercise on the wearer. That's a lot of tech in a small denture.
We need to ensure everyday denture and prosthetic materials will be used to ensure it's streamlined, comfortable, and won't affect breathing. We wouldn't want him to notice he's even wearing it.
One more technology that is rapidly becoming pervasive and will be one of the most important technologies to change our world, to change our profession, and to change our lives, is artificial intelligence. And there's not just one type of artificial intelligence, but they really work together. Information comes in, whether it's research from patients, from the population as a whole, whether it's detailed analysis of an individual patient's requirements, tools such as natural language processing, associative memory for pattern recognition, and machine learning can help AI-based systems make decisions, analyze problems, and even recommend actions with a level of expertise that begins to approach that of people who are experts in their field. Now, these systems will never have, in my opinion, the ability to integrate creativity and intelligence at quite the level that we have today, or certainly not for another generation or two, if not longer. But as we look out over the next 5, 10, 20 years, we're going to see AI become increasingly powerful in terms of assisting us in doing our jobs better, faster, and more accurately, to point out things that we might have overlooked, to do the routine low-level analysis that is otherwise very difficult and time-consuming, do it quickly and accurately, and free us up to use our judgment, creativity, and experience to build on what AI systems can do. Now, to give you an example in the healthcare field that took place about 18 months ago, IBM's Watson artificial intelligence engine, helped identify a rare form of leukemia that a woman in Japan had. She had been misdiagnosed, but the doctors couldn't understand. She had all the characteristics that indicated she had a particular form of leukemia which should have responded to the treatment she was given, and yet she was not responding to it. What Watson did, when they turned to Watson to try to help resolve this woman's problem, was over the course of about 24 hours, Watson read 20,000 medical journal articles, analyzed them for patterns, compared them to the detailed history for this particular woman, and recognized as a result that although it was extremely similar, she had a slightly different form of leukemia than she had been diagnosed with. One that would not respond to the treatments she was being given, but that would respond to a different treatment. And in fact, as a result of acting on this and changing her treatment, the woman has fully recovered from the process. Now, it's not very practical for anybody to go to their orthodontist or any other medical professional today and say, gee, I'm having an unusual problem. Would you go home tonight and read 20,000 medical journal articles to try to help me figure out what it is? But again, with artificial intelligence, we're going to see tremendous changes in how we practice in healthcare in general. We're also going to see AI be used for the concept of what is now becoming referred to as cobotics, cooperative robotics. Now, how many people have heard of the computer chess games chess players can play against? Okay, and most of you have probably heard that some 20 years ago, a specialized computer built by IBM beat the world champion in chess. Nowadays, the world champion, when they ask him, do you play against computers? He said that, well, of course, I use computers to practice all the time. And they said, yes, but do you play matches against computers to see if you can beat them? He said, why would I want to waste my time trying to play a competitive match against a computer? That would be like asking an Olympic sprinter if he wanted to run a race against an automobile. I wouldn't have a chance against a computer anymore. The top computers can beat the top grandmasters in the world. But there is something that can beat the top computers in the world in chess. And that's what's called advanced or freestyle chess teams. And what they do is they compare, they have a team, a person, working with the computer. They don't have to be a grandmaster. They have to be an excellent chess player, a master-level player. But a master-level player using a computer, and it doesn't have to be the world's most powerful, dedicated supercomputer, just a good, strong, computerized chess program, the two of those working together can actually beat not only any grandmaster chess player, but they can also beat any computerized supercomputer chess program in the world. The combination of the human judgment, creativity, and experience combined with the tremendous power of artificial intelligence. And we're seeing the same thing in many other fields, including increasingly we will see it in healthcare as people work with robots and or work with artificial intelligence analytical systems. And it may be, as we move to a cobotic environment, that your new nurse assistant will look something more like this.
The skin is so smooth, the hair and the eyes, well, lifelike, until you watch Dan Popa go to work.
Do you like robots?
Naturally, I love robots. It's my species.
Do you like humans?
That's funny.
Popa is the human here, having a conversation with a robot he created.
I do research in robotics.
Popa is an electrical and computer engineering professor at the University of Louisville. He and his robots came to U of L from Texas this year. bringing with them a big money grant from the National Science Foundation.
The project is about creating a next generation robot nurse assistants. And I stress assistants because these are not nurses, or they will not replace nurses, but they will essentially make nurses more productive. They will help them do their job better. And the patients will also benefit in the process.
Popa and his team are training robot prototypes like this one to respond to commands and learn repetitive motions so they could serve as 24-hour patient sitters, picking up gloves, fetching water, or helping a patient walk down a hospital hallway.
We can right now instruct the robot to find and grab a glass of water. It will be successful maybe 85% of the time, meaning that 15% of the time it will either drop the glass or knock off the glass, right? So in order for this to be deployed in a hospital or a home, it needs to be successful 99.9% of the time. So some of the research is focused on how do we actually increase that reliability to those kinds of levels.
They're also developing skin for the robots, which frankly feels a little creepy, but serves two purposes: a way to attach and hide sensors, and a way to make the robots look human.
If the robot looks like a child or like Albert Einstein or somebody who's been a positive figure in history, then people will be accepting. But if it looks like a nefarious character or a zombie or something like that, of course you're gonna get repulsed. So appearance has something to do with it. I don't think people realize that this technology is very close to being deployed. I believe that within 5 to 10 years, you'll be going to the store, and buying a next appliance for your house, and that's gonna be a robot. And then you're gonna bring this appliance home and you're gonna teach it to do certain things that interest you.
Now, anybody here more than 40 years old is old enough to remember that 30 years ago, when we first began seeing portable cellular phones, not very many people had them. They were large and unwieldy. They didn't work very well. They weren't very efficient. They were extremely primitive by today's standards. And if anybody had suggested 30 years ago to most people that within the next 25 to 30 years, everyone in the world would be walking around with highly intelligent, computerized smartphones that could perform a tremendously wide variety of tasks, everybody would have just said, "You're absolutely crazy. This primitive device will never accomplish that." And it didn't happen overnight. But we evolved to the point where we now have everybody in the audience that has one with them, hold up your smartphone. Okay? I think most of the people here have smartphones with them. Of course. We take it for granted today. And yet, it's something that would have been completely unexpected 30 years ago. It's not going to take 30 years for robots to become as widely accepted in our global society as it did for cell phones and then smartphones. What we have today in terms of robotics, like the video you just looked at, very primitive by what emerging future standards will be. Robots are not going to suddenly appear overnight doing everything that we envision from science fiction movies, but what is going to happen is that they will slowly evolve, become more capable. We will get used to the idea of having robots, not necessarily always humanoid-looking robots, although in many cases we'll see that, but having robots in our environments, whether it's kids playing with them, whether it's receptionists in our office, whether it's even nurse orthodontic assistants, we will evolve in that direction again over the next several years. Now there's another very exciting technology that people, for the most part, have just heard about in the last year or two. And most people haven't yet come to recognize how profoundly this emerging technology is going to change healthcare, orthodontics, and other forms of healthcare, and the world in general in a way very analogous to how the internet has changed our world over the last 20 years. You heard me refer to the notion of online smart contracts. And the phrase that I used in talking about smart contracts and electronic health records was blockchain-based smart contracts. Blockchain technology is a technology that has already been recognized by the very conservative business publication, The Economist, some 2 years ago, said that blockchain technology is the biggest advance in human record keeping. Since the invention of the double entry bookkeeping system in Florence, Italy in 1494, over 500 years ago, it is hugely going to impact businesses and industries around the world for four reasons. One, blockchains enable you to create permanent, immutable, signed and time-stamped records of identity, of ownership, of transactions, of contractual commitments. Secondly, blockchains allow those records to be shared among two or more entities, people or organizations, doctors, nurses, patients, clinics, hospital systems, insurance companies, governmental agencies who participate in a given business, social, or healthcare ecosystem without any of those participants having to rely on any one of the others to be the so-called master record keeper, and without having to pay a third-party intermediary to be the master record keeper. Everyone who is authorized to see that information can see it easily, with complete transparency, and if they're authorized to update that information, such as a doctor's office, an orthodontic practitioner updating the treatment plan for a particular patient to their blockchain-based electronic medical record, will be able to make those updates quickly and easily. At the same time, it provides unhackable security against anyone unauthorized to update that information or even to see that information from being able to do so. Now, as soon as I make the comment that an emerging technology is unhackable, the first thing most people say is, but wait a minute. Given enough time and resources, isn't it possible for hackers to hack into any computer? And that's absolutely correct. And that's why blockchain-based data is not stored on any computer. It's stored on many computers. Depending on the implementation, identical copies of the blockchain data are stored on anywhere from hundreds to thousands of computers all over the internet, all over the world. Using the most advanced cryptography and synchronization technologies in the world, anytime information is updated on any one of those blockchain locations or nodes, it is immediately, within minutes if not seconds, replicated at every other node on that blockchain. Which means that if a hacker were somehow to break into a single one of those blockchain nodes and make illicit changes to the information on the blockchain, all the rest of the nodes would simply compare their information with that one and say, this copy of the blockchain, this node does not agree with all of the rest of us on the blockchain. Ignore that information, it's no longer valid. And only the valid information would then remain on all of the other copies of the blockchain around the world. Now, blockchain technology has existed for almost 10 years. It was originally proposed in a paper that was published in October of 2008, suggesting how blockchain technology, this particular approach, which has come to be known as blockchain technology, could be used for the development of a digital electronic currency, which they referred to as Bitcoin. How many people have heard of Bitcoin? Everybody by now, of course. And yet Bitcoin's been around for nearly a decade. It's the oldest and largest application of blockchain technology. And it actually is about money. Over the last 9 years since people started moving money around via Bitcoin, hundreds of billions of dollars worth of money have been moved around via Bitcoin. And yet, despite the concerted efforts of the most cunning digital criminals in the world, the Bitcoin blockchain has never been hacked. People have been able to hack into electronic wallets, into online exchanges. So you hear occasionally of Bitcoin being stolen, but it's not stolen from the blockchain. It's stolen from people or organizations who have not stored their Bitcoin data securely. The blockchain itself has never been hacked. In order to be able to hack the Bitcoin blockchain, which has over 7,000 nodes worldwide, you would have to hack a majority of all of those nodes. And you'd have to hack them all at the same time, because the Bitcoin blockchain synchronizes every 10 minutes. And as soon as the blockchain resynchronizes, any attempt to hack in and steal or change data from that Bitcoin blockchain would be over, and they'd have to start all over again. One physicist estimated that the amount of energy that would be required to drive the amount of computing power that would be needed to simultaneously hack a majority of the 7,000 nodes on the Bitcoin blockchain, make exactly identical changes to the information on all of those nodes that were hacked, and complete that entire process within 10 minutes before the blockchain resynchronized, would be approximately equal to the amount of energy emitted during that same 10-minute period of time by the sun. So while it is not, in a purely mathematical sense, completely impossible to ever hack a blockchain, for all practical purposes, it becomes economically impossible. There are simply vastly better ways for criminals to spend their resources than attempting to hack something that is that difficult to hack. This is much more powerful security and capability than we have ever had on the internet or computer systems in general prior to the emergence of blockchain, and it's going to impact us tremendously in the years to come. So people began asking the question a few years ago, if we can use the blockchain technology to move something as fungible and valuable as digital currencies around, why not use it for the digital representation of other important information like the title to my car, or the deed to my home, or our electronic medical records? For 20 years now, around the world, we've been fighting a losing battle trying to solve the problem of how do we allow for medical practitioners across various areas of practice in various geographical locations to be able to quickly and easily share electronic medical records with their patients and with other practitioners, while at the same time ensuring that no one who's not authorized to see that important personal health information is able to see it. And the reason we haven't been able to solve that problem is that solving that problem was simply beyond the capabilities of the technologies that existed. Blockchain provides the capabilities to solve that problem. And we're going to be seeing over the next few years, we are already beginning to see solutions emerge which provide for the quick and easy sharing of medical information with other practitioners, with patients, while at the same time preserving, securing, and preserving the security of that important medical information for the patients. We're also seeing emerging on blockchains is what are called smart contracts. Now, a smart contract is more than just a digital representation of a traditional contract that you might draw up using a word processing system and then store it on the blockchain so that you have a record of that contract, although that in and of itself would provide some value. But smart contracts, in fact, are dynamic. They can automatically be self-enforcing. It's actually a computer program which runs on the blockchain and can take custody over assets on that blockchain and which can track what has happened to date and respond to incoming information or events. So you can have a smart contract that says, given that the doctor and patient have agreed on a certain treatment plan and the health insurance company has approved payment for that plan, the doctor is now authorized to download the design for a set of dynamic smart braces to the 3D printers in his or her office and can start purchasing them now, and the contract can be structured in such a way that payment to the provider of the design for that smart, those smart braces will automatically take place on completion of the successful download. Or that upon completion of placement of the brackets on the patient's teeth and approval by the patient and the doctor that that step of the process has been completed, a progress payment is automatically transferred from the insurance company and the patient's accounts into the doctor's account in real time. How many people would like their patients to pay them immediately in cash at the moment they walk out of the office without having to ask for the money or the patient have to take any action rather than send a bill to their patient and wait for that money to come in? Would it be nicer to get paid that quickly? Of course. We're going to be moving toward a world where this is commonplace. One of the important things that makes electronic medical records on the blockchain possible is the notion of self-sovereign digital identity. When I entered the diplomatic compound here by the Cultural Palace this morning, the gentleman who was guarding the entrance asked me for ID. Fortunately, I had remembered to bring my passport along with me from the hotel room, showed it to me, and he showed it to him, and he waved me on in. How does he know I'm the person on that passport? Well, I guess I look a little bit like the picture. How does he know it's a valid passport? Well, he's seen passports before. He probably has some idea what a U.S. passport might look like. But the fact of the matter is, in this particular case, we're dependent on a third-party organization. For my passport, it's the United States State Department that has decided that we're going to issue a document that Jack Shaw can carry around with him to prove who he is. But if you get more fundamental, how do you really know who is the person that purports to be the person indicated on that document? Well, with blockchain technology, you can actually capture biometric information about that individual. My fingerprints, voice print, facial scan, retinal scans. Tie that back to other documentary information, such as passports or national ID cards or driver's licenses, as well as the more traditional information to identify who is that person's name, what's their address, their telephone number, their date of birth, and store that in an immutable record that's not under control of the State Department, of a government agency, of a bank, but is under control of the individual for whom that record starts being built at birth. Now, this is going to be an evolutionary process over the next 5 to 10 to 20 years and more. But we will look back at the days when people carried pieces of paper around to document who they were as being extremely primitive within another. Did we lose? We good? Okay. And what this is going to be able to do is by having self-sovereign digital identity, the person will be able to prove that I am the person to whom that set of electronic medical records belongs. And therefore, I am the one and only person who can authorize that information to be shared with a particular orthodontist or a particular insurance company so that it can be updated by them appropriately or read by them appropriately. There's no reason the insurance company needs to have the ability to update the medical record with treatment plans. But they do need to have the ability to read that information to know that the treatment has been being conducted so that they can make the appropriate payments on a timely basis. So by having self-sovereign digital identity, first of all, identity theft, as we know about it, will be disappearing in the near future. It will allow us to confirm professional credentials, which means that I can post an orthodontic record on there but say that nobody in the world can see that unless you can validate via your own self-sovereign digital identity that you are an authorized orthodontist and one who has an office within a 15-minute drive of my home if I want to consider doing. Otherwise, I'm not going to bother to share this information with you. First of all, nobody who's not an orthodontist should see that information. And if you're too far from my home, why bother you or me to share it unnecessarily? Blockchain also ties back to the Internet of Things, because just as it's very important to know who is the orthodontist we're dealing with, who is the patient that the orthodontist is dealing with, it's also important to know about things. 3 years ago, in the year 2015, the number of things connected to the Internet exceeded the number of people connected to the Internet with more than 5 billion things. Now there's twice as many things as people connected to the Internet, and by the end of the 2020s, we will see more than a trillion things connected to the Internet. Some of those things may well be dynamic smart brackets and braces residing on the teeth of particular patients. But how will we know when our systems get a signal that indicates it's coming from a particular patient, that signal actually was originated from that patient, and which specific smart bracket on which tooth in that patient's mouth that signal indicating movement and pressure has come from? This is where, again, the concept of digital identity can be applied to specific things. Each bracket will have a unique, verifiable digital identity. So before the analysis is completed, we know exactly which information came from which tooth and which patient's mouth those teeth are in with certainty, so that when we transmit back the information saying, here's how the forces applied by the various brackets in this set of dynamic smart braces are to be adjusted to improve the treatment plan, we know at the very least we're changing the patient's treatment plan for the right patient, and we're not sending it out for the wrong patient. But we're already seeing this technology as an example put in place, not in patients, not in orthodontics yet. That's a few years out in the future. But to give you an example, the German technology company Bosch has already developed a system using Internet of Things technology and blockchain technology working together to verify that the odometer readings from cars are stored, updated every few minutes on an immutable, unchangeable blockchain record, so that when the person comes to sell their car, even if they said, I'm going to try to increase the value of my car by setting back the odometer in the car, it won't do any good because there's already an unchangeable blockchain record of what was the maximum mileage on that car. And in the country of Germany, It's estimated that 13% of all automotive sales have odometers that have been changed. It may be worse than some other countries. This is something that will stop that process completely. So this is technology that, while still relatively primitive to what I described in our visit to the orthodontist in the 2020s, will be evolving to support the kinds of capabilities that we talked about. So by having patient-mediated health data exchange via blockchain technology, it means that for practitioners, patients, and healthcare institutions, we will now be able to have accountability, transparency, privacy, security, control, provenance in the sense of knowing exactly who made changes or updates to a particular patient's record at what point in time, all controlled via consent management under the control and authority ultimately of the patient, or where appropriate, an authorized caregiver of the patient. So what does all this mean for you as orthodontists? How is this going to affect what you do when you go home from the conference? Well, quite frankly, none of this is necessarily going to have any immediate effect on the actions you take today or tomorrow, but it is certainly going to have an effect on the future of your practice as you plan for how your practice is going to evolve over the next 2 to 3 to 5 or even 10 years. And as Dr. Nguyen pointed out very well in talking about 3D printers, don't make your decisions based only on what you think might be the right decision today with your blinders on to the future. Step back, look at how things are changing in your environment, and look at how you would like to see your orthodontic practice evolve, so that you can take full advantage of emerging technologies, so that you don't overspend by investing too soon in technologies that are not yet mature enough, and you don't lose efficiency, productivity, cost savings, and a competitive position in the market by waiting too long to invest in those technologies that are the appropriate ones. You should have a 3 to 5 year plan. It's not simply about taking individual technologies and force-fitting them into the practice the way it works today. It's about rethinking the entire model of your system and then using any and all of the technologies over time to help evolve your practice to what you would like to envision it to be in the near to intermediate future. Now, in working with people and organizations in a wide range of industries, including healthcare, over the years, we've learned that a practice called Third Horizon Planning works very well in this area. Now, First Horizon Planning is just about, it's what you should be doing today anyway. Sitting down once a year or so and saying, what do we need to do better or different in our existing practice? Where do we need to change our procedures? Where do we need to change our business practices? Where do we need to upgrade our technologies and our tools? Enhancements and extensions to that, improved operational efficiencies and so forth. But third horizon planning is a little different. It's developing the long-term vision of how your digital practice should be working 2 to 3 to 5 years from now in the emerging digital orthodontic ecosystem of the early 2020s. It parallels First Horizon Planning, but you take away today's constraints. That's why you need to look into the future a few years. And what this does is allows a time cushion. It says, well, we may not be able to make certain changes in the next 3 months or 6 months, but yes, if we look 2 or 3 or 5 years down the road, we certainly could change any system, process, assets, infrastructure, technology that we use. We'll have the time and resources to make those changes so that you can rethink your business models and how you manage your practice overall and consider what could be enabled. How could we be doing it better and differently by taking advantage of emerging technologies? Identify multiple possible scenarios. The idea isn't to lock yourself in and say, well, this is the one and only path we can follow. identify optional variations on that path. Because you can't predict the future with certainty. So consider various different options and approaches, which would be the most desirable right now, but with the flexibility to shift to others if some things move faster or slower or in different ways from what we anticipate. In between, the second horizon planning is about identifying some of those most promising long-term opportunities and beginning to invest in new technologies and business practices. How many people here are using 3D printers in your practice today? Can I see your hands, please, if you're already using 3D printers? Okay, most of you are not using them yet. Okay, I've visited several orthodontists in the area. Now, I would add to Dr. Nguyen's recommendations regarding 3D printers. Don't wait until you're ready to start using a 3D printer in production to go out and spend tens of thousands of dollars to buy a production 3D printer when you have no experience in working with them. Go out and buy a low-end, inexpensive 3D printer that you can start to play with and practice with. Invest in your own knowledge and expertise. Buy that $1,000 3D printer. Don't wait. If you're not ready to buy the $25,000 or $15,000 printer, buy the $1,000 one just to work with it in your spare time, on the weekends or in the evenings, to become familiar with what it does, how it works, so that when you are ready, whether it's 6 weeks from now or 6 months from now or 2 years from now, to invest in 3D printing as an important part of your process, you've learned about it. You understand from hands-on experience what it can do, what you can't do, how you want to be able to use that in your practice. So the summary of Third Horizon Planning is, it's planned and executed in three parts. You develop the long-term vision, including what kinds of technologies do we want to have? How is blockchain-based electronic medical records going to start influencing your practice? Well, for many of you, they won't directly influence your practice until the software providers that you work with incorporate blockchain-enabled functionality into their software practice management systems. But again, that doesn't mean that you just should sit back and ignore the subject until your software providers come to you and tell you they're going to bestow this wonderful capability on you. Go out to the booths and ask them today, what support do they have for blockchain? Start learning about it and understanding how this technology is going to change the way that you manage electronic medical records, that you get reimbursed and paid by your clients or their insurance companies for your services. Start investigating and learning about these new technologies that will be part of your plan. Of course, consider how your business is going to evolve, how your practice is going to evolve, and start to develop experience. The idea being, as you develop experience and understanding with new technologies, you merge that with the continued evolution of your existing business plan so that you get to a point 2 to 3 to 5 years from now where you are actually functioning in the way that you envision yourself to be functioning. Now, of course, that's never going to be cast in concrete, because even if by 5 years from now you've achieved your vision of the future, there will be a new set of futures available to you. Still further enhancements to existing technologies, new technologies that emerge that we haven't thought about yet. The end result will be that the orthodontic practice of the 2020s will involve a host of capabilities that we have to much lesser degree than today. Patients automatically booking patient appointments as required. Signing in with their health statistics and medications already updated via blockchain-based electronic medical records. Where your exam chair automatically adjusts to the patient by identifying who they are as they walk up to approach it and sit in it. Where a robot undertakes basic examinations, leaving you to do skilled work, ably assisted by a robotic nurse. Where patients' stress levels during treatment are even monitored remotely and lighting and background music adjusted to keep the patients comfortable as possible during their treatments. Where they leave, having paid automatically and with the next appointment booked and communicated to their smartphones. It seems like a lot of change. And if you look back over the last 10 years in our lives since the first smartphones appeared, it seems like our world has changed quite a bit. But let me promise you, if you think things have changed a lot in the last 10 years, you ain't seen nothing yet. We will see more change in the next 10 years than we've seen in the past 50 years. So how are you going to accommodate all that change? It starts by changing your mental attitude. You've got to be willing to not merely accept change when it's forced on you. You've got to actively embrace change, not change just for the purpose of changing, but change to help you and your practice take full advantage of emerging technologies and emerging best practices to the benefit of your patients and your business. You've got to change your business processes. You've got to change your model of practice. And you've got to participate in the change of the overall orthodontic ecosystem. That's a lot of change. But as the great historian Henry Steele Commager put so well, more than a century ago, change does not necessarily assure progress, but progress implacably requires change. Let me encourage you to take advantage of emerging tools and technologies to change your practice, to change your lives, and change the world in ways that will benefit us all. Thank you very much for listening. Shukran.
Thank you, Dr. Jackshaw, for a very interesting lecture.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Sorry, doctor.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.